Service leader today, Reverend Lori Stavitz, will offer our sermon, Speak for the Trees. First, we have a few announcements. Be sure to check out your weekly service bulletin. It lists the many activities and groups that are meeting on Zoom, except Tai Chi, which meets in person on Monday mornings in our parking lot. If you are interested in receiving the weekly bulletin or learning more about us, please send an email to office@lakecountyuu.net or leave your email in the chat box and we can get a hold of you. You can control the volume of what you hear on your computer by going up to the little speaker probably at the top and clicking on it, and you'll see a slider that you can slide to the right to make it louder or the left to make it quieter. Our service is being recorded today, except for the joys and concerns and the discussion period after the service. If you want to listen to any previous services, they are on our YouTube channel, UUCLC Office, which you can easily access through the link in the weekly bulletin or our website. You can also donate to UUCLC in the chat box. Funding link. And are there any other announcements today?
Christy, Russ has his hand up.
Okay, Russ.
I have a couple of things. One is that next Sunday, Jane Hepting has arranged for Reverend Mike Watkins and the congregants from his church, the CME Church in Tavares, to join us for our service. So we will have guests at that point. Some of you know that we have been involved largely through the Social Justice and Environment Committee with Mike Watkins and his some of his congregants in social justice efforts. And this is an attempt to let people know how we do things. We had an invitation to join Mike's church earlier, and some of us did. So he'll be joining us next Sunday. The other thing is I would urge you to take a look at the announcements that have been sent out. There's also been an email sent out announcing that next Sunday we will have the announcement of the slate of candidates for the open board positions. There are four of them, secretary, treasurer, and two trustee positions. You can read a little more detail about that in the email you should have received if you're a voting member, at least. There is, as I said, an announcement in the bulletin today. Thank you.
Thanks, Russ. I'm looking forward to that next week. I had attended his service a month ago or whenever we went. It was really interesting. Anybody else? Are there any other hands up?
I don't see any.
Thank you. Okay, welcome to all of you this morning. If you are a first-time visitor and are comfortable doing so, I invite you to wave your hand. And when you're called on, you can unmute and introduce yourself and tell us what brought you here today. Is there anybody?
Nothing seen.
Thank you. I want to give a warm welcome today to Reverend Lori Stavitz, who has been serving congregations for over 20 years. She is currently the minister of the UU Church of Utica, New York. And she received her undergrad degree in therapeutic recreation and obtain her master in theological today and speak for the trees. Welcome, Reverend Lori.
Thank you so much, Christine. I was having a little problem with the connection here, so I hope that I'm coming through loud and clear to all of you this morning. It's a joy to be with you and to bring a topic that is near and dear to my heart. So I would like to start with a chalice lighting and some opening words. If you will imagine that we are all in a room together this morning as we light this chalice and connecting ourselves together in this room. As trees are rocked and shaken by storms and strong winds, so we too find ourselves challenged and tested. Our worries and our concerns sometimes threaten to upend us. So, therefore, let us deepen our roots in the rich soil of love and community. Let us weave the branches of our lives with the outstretched arms of neighbors and strangers. May we too power that pulse that runs through our veins like sap in the trees, enabling us to grow as we offer up our own unique gifts of sweetness and beauty. We light our chalice this morning as we turn toward the light, as we transform its glow and warmth to nourish the larger life of which we are all a part. Welcome, and let us worship together.
Each Sunday, we make time for those who wish to offer a joy, concern, or sorrow. And this portion of our service will not be recorded. Were there any in the chat box, any joys and concerns that we need to share? Would someone read those, please? Carol, could you read those?
Yes, was unmuting. Okay. From Julie Champion, today is Jack Champion's birthday. He would have been 84.
Okay, thank you. Keeping these in mind, we will now have a minute of silence. Please get comfortable and spend this time in whatever way helps you to best calm your mind. Mm-hmm. Let us reaffirm who we are by reciting together our congregational covenant. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. It is our practice to give generously to our church as we are able, and keeping in mind both its meaning in our lives and its impact on the world. We are thankful to all who provide financial support to UUCLC. And in order to keep our virtual service going and to keep our beautiful building safe and ready for our eventual return, we ask for whatever financial support you can provide. There are multiple ways to do this. You can make a pledge in the chat box right now. And thank you for your donation today.
Christopher Robin and I walk along under branches lit up by the moon, posing our questions to Al and Dior as our days disappeared all too soon. But I've wandered much further today than I should, and I can't seem to find my way back to the wood. So help me if you can, I've got to get back to the house and move on by one. You'd be surprised, there's so much to be done. Count all the bees in the hive, chase all the clouds from the sky, back to the days of Christopher Robin and Pooh. Got a honey jar stuck on his nose. He came to me asking help and advice, and from here no one knows where he goes. So I sent him to ask the owl if he's there, how to loosen a jar from the nose of a bear. So help me if you can, I've got to get to the house that you call by one. You'd be surprised, there's so much to be done. Count all the bees in the hive, chase all the clouds from the sky, back to the days of Christopher Robin and Pooh.
Our first reading today is called Connection to Trees, Forest Bathing. Before I start the reading, I want to briefly share my own forest bathing experience. About 30 years ago, we had received a whole foot of powdery snow up in Michigan, and I had a snow day off school, and I was skiing alone in the woods behind our home. You native Floridians may not know that snow really insulates the sound as it clings to the trees. As I approached a beautiful forest valley blanketed in snow, the absolute silence made my ears ring. There I was, gliding along on my skis, sliding rhythmically across the snow, under a cathedral of towering pine trees and hardwoods. Just felt like I was in a cathedral. I felt at one with the forest, and it was a sacred space to me. So I really connected to this reading. And it's called again, Connection to Trees, Forest Bathing. Trees are more than woods. Perhaps you have a childhood connection to a tree or a special place in a forest or grove. If you have ever spent time basking in the glow of a summer day in a forest or the beauty and silence of a winter moonlight trek in the deep woods, you know the wonder and joy of trees. The link between life on earth and forests is no secret. Take a deep breath. In the past few years, researchers have confirmed the direct relationship that trees have on our bodies, minds, and spirits. However, this has long been known by ancient peoples. The deep immersion into the green is understood as a restorative practice in Japan. Shimrin Yoku is the practice of forest bathing. For many, our local parks are where we go to bathe in the trees. However, many of our trees are on a decline. We need to do more than replant. We need to take seriously our need to grow a worldwide forest now.
Twin Maples reading from Braiding Sweetgrass. There was a custom in the mid-1800s of planting twin trees to celebrate a marriage and starting of a home. However, the couple were never the ones who would benefit from the deep shade outside their home. They must have been thinking of the future generations to come who would think back and remember their love and sit in the comfort of those two trees, Braiding Sweetgrass. Excuse me. Birth. In Israel, it is customary to plant a birth tree for every child, most often a cedar. In China, the emperor tree is the tree of choice. Similar customs in Africa and throughout the world exist. For those of you wondering what to give those who already have everything or too much, you are among the many who are thinking outside the box when it comes to presents and parties. Parties with a purpose have become a way to engage young and old alike in meaningful celebration of birthdays and milestone events. How fun it would be to plant a tree and host a teddy bear picnic or a Pooh Bear picnic. Or make a toast to a loved one turning 84 in the beginning shade of their very own legacy tree. Something we can do outside as we continue to social distance. As more and more people make end of life decisions and include cremation and green burials, it is becoming more accustomed to bury remains along with the planting of a tree. Our many local cemeteries have requested that new trees be planted. What a wonderful way to honor a loved one and increase the tree canopy. There are many ways to grow a forest right where you are now.
Let's continue with the sweetgrass from Dr. Robin Wall Kimmer. She notes, in old times, our elders would say the trees talked to each other, that they would hold their own counsel and craft a plan. Well, the scientists decided long ago that plants could not speak. However, it seems that our ancient elders were right. The trees and plants can speak with one another. There is now compelling evidence that the trees are talking to one another via pheromones, which are hormones, compounds that are sent out on the breezes, laden with meaning. Scientists have identified now specific messages that one tree will release to communicate to other trees when under stress from insect attacks. They set out distress calls and warn the others of coming danger so that they can prepare themselves in advance. They are also communicating messages underground to share nutrients, making sure they're distributed evenly to everyone, so the tree, one tree does not benefit more from being in rich soil while neighbors are starving.
Thank you all for sharing those readings to help us begin diving deeper into the subject this morning. Again, I'm Reverend Lori Staubitz, and this particular sermon and service is near and dear to my heart. In past lives, I've served as an environmental education chair for the Sierra Club. And also have worked to save forests around the world, including the Tongass in Alaska and the Ozarks from clear cutting. So I have a lifelong passion for trees and have been planting them for many years now. And one of my life goals is to plant a forest before I die. And so I need to live a lot longer, but I'm making headway, and part of that is involving and engaging others to do the same. But the importance of trees, okay, is sometimes something that we really don't pay close attention to. And again, I invite you to take another deep breath. And as you breathe out, particularly right now with the struggles that people have for breathing with COVID, our breath is become front and center into our lives with the threat of climate change and global warming. Breathing, having access to clean air is so much in the forefront of many of our minds. But take another deep breath. And as you breathe out, give thanks. Give thanks because there are at least 7 trees that have been working hard since you were born to create enough air for your life alone. For each child that's born, there needs to be at least 7 large old growth trees to sustain that life here on our planet. And that's not to mention the heating and fuel and some of the other, our shelters. We have so much to be grateful for trees. But you know, they are so closely woven with human life that they have made their way into religious symbolism as well as religious history. The tree of life, and I know I have my tree of life pendant on this morning and a tree of life symbol behind me. This symbol is an ancient one. Our ancestors, they worshiped in places that were surrounded by trees. In fact, many of the cathedrals that exist a lot around the planet today, and the mosques and some of the sacred sites have been built on places where there were once sacred groves. Probably some of the most famous, of course, are the cedars of Lebanon. And at one point in history, the entire mountains in Lebanon were covered with ancient, beautiful trees. But today, there remain 12 giant cedars, and it is illegal to do anything to those trees. They are protected. They are known not just by the Israelites as the 12 friends of Solomon. Christians refer to them as the apostles, and Muslims refer to them as the saints. And every year, hundreds of thousands of people go and make a pilgrimage to that site. You know, the shape, of course, of the Jewish menorah comes from the tree, and so does the cross. And for those of you that celebrate solstice and the Christian traditions in December, you already know that the evergreen has a special place in our religious history, as the wreath itself is a symbolic evergreen that symbolizes the wholeness and the full circle of life. In fact, it was the ancient Celts who brought in a evergreen in a pot. It was potted, brought into their house and decorated with small little fish and with nuts and with fruits to celebrate the fact that this tree was symbolic of eternal life. And I can't help but hope and think that our practice of cutting down evergreens and bringing them in will someday stop, and that we will, maybe if we need a potted tree indoors, do the same and then look for a place to plant it. Anne Gordon writes that all of us are born mystics. And I think that for the Celtic, in the Celtic tradition, the mysticism that connected people to the forests is still alive and well today. We can see that is actually making, I hope, a comeback where people are seeking out, especially during COVID, finding a place to be that's life-giving, and forests are where they are going. But Anne Gordon says, all of us are born mystics, and for the capacity to experience wonder and a primal sense of connectedness with all life is our birthright. Many of us have been cut off from anything green as we've had to harbor indoors during this time. In people in urban settings with the limited park access, you know, being human is to be connected to the green. I want to get back with Anne. She said that making our way into a period when the dualisms of the past are giving way to holistic thinking. So the idea that we are separate from other life is now making almost full circle to the place where we are part of the natural world. We are not separate from it. In theologian Richard Niebuhr said that passages into a larger, more encompassing life takes place in our acts of connection with living beings whom we, in our casual unmindfulness, treat as separate from ourselves. And take a deep breath again and a breathe out. We are so dependent on the life of a tree for our own life. Self and world are linked in an ever-expanding circle. And when we plant a tree, we are rooting ourselves in the earth. Buddhist ecologist Joan Halifax said that even in our acts of composting, we are connecting to the earth. When we are doing things that help sustain us. And, you know, even if you're in an urban setting and far from a forest, the fact that, you know, even recycling is a way of participating in this global kind of life-giving force that gives life, new life, and brings back life as breathing in and breathing out to sustain life upon our planet. You've heard many quotes already from Robin Wall Kimmerer, who is actually a professor of biology in Syracuse. And she is a Native American woman who wrote Braiding Sweetgrass. And I have to say, it's been one of my favorite reads the past year. If you get a chance to read it, I think it will touch your minds and hearts. I want to quote again, another reading from Robin. She says that in our Western ways of thinking and being, we've been taught that there's this hierarchy of being, a ladder where humans are on top. Well, God, some people put God up there, then the humans, and it works. We work our way down, with animals and plants being at the very bottom. But Native American wisdom teaches that humans actually have the least experience with how to live upon this planet, and that we need to look to other species to actually learn how to live in harmony with one another and with other beings on this planet. So she said that Native American spirituality teaches to look to other beings as a source of wisdom. My own awareness of trees began and has its roots in my childhood. I was privileged to grow up in a small town surrounded by fields, meadows, and forests. And at the time when children were allowed to be free range, and so I was, and with my friends, we spent many a time, hence the Pooh Corner, many times, in going down into the woods and playing and being immersed all day in forests and meadows. I even had a tree friend. Old Sappy was a large pine. And one of my rituals as a child was the first snowfall. I would run down and I would sit in Old Sappy's arms and just listen to that quiet. I know Chris shared that incredible quiet that comes with the snow and the and being in these branches. And that type of spirituality is important for our children, to be able to connect to green places, for your grandchildren and great-grandchildren, to have places where they can do that, to connect that deeply to life itself. Granting trees their status as sentient beings is more than a childish fantasy. Although many people continue to scoff at that, I think that perhaps we distance ourselves from acknowledging trees as truly alive beings so that we can continue to destroy forests and cut them down without thought. In fact, it was just recently along the Erie Canal, they decided to cut down a lot of the trees because they thought they were infringing on the structure of the canal, which may have been true in some parts, but not all parts. And so we were witness to a clear cutting of trees along our beloved towpath walks. And one woman shared with me that she was so distressed. She shared with her husband, you know, how upsetting this was. And her husband's reply was, "What are you now, a tree hugger?" Equating compassion for trees as some far out kind of childish whim or cultish behavior limits the access we have culturally and religiously as people of faith to the deepening of our connections to the source of life. But when we dare to press those boundaries, when we dare to open ourselves up to that larger reality, and even start to talk and speak as though trees are alive, and treating them as they are cohabitating beings with us, we begin to change the culture around us. When you dare to be a tree hugger, at the expense of the ridicule that you may experience among friends and family, believe me, it does take some risk. But I do think it's time. I think it's time that we start that kind of acknowledgement. Years ago, while living in Virginia, in Richmond, Virginia, I was there with my children during Irma, where the hurricane struck head on, and we had lost power for 9 days. But that wasn't the most devastating thing. What was devastating is to witness the live, the just incredibly large, ancient oaks in the parks. You know, lots of these trees were large during the Civil War and still there. They were upended. It was like watching beached whales all around throughout the city. And it was devastating for me to witness that, but it was also, I kept thinking, what were these trees experiencing? What was this like to be uprooted and still be alive like that? And that deepened my connection, thinking that way, deepened my connection and strengthened that kind of resolve to start to see trees truly as land whales. In fact, when I'm driving down the highway and I'm looking out at forests, I'm often trying in my head to see them as the beings for which they are. But it wasn't always like this. Again, Robin Kimmerer would remind us that in the English language, we refer to what we see as non-sentient beings, plants, a lot of animals, as it. She said that would be a profound act of disrespect in at least in her Native American tribe. It robs a person of selfhood and kinship and reduces living beings, trees, to mere things. So in indigenous traditions, in their language itself, they refer to them as family. And so she said that when we ask a question rather than, you know, what tree is it? She says, we ask, who is this being? Who is this being? And the answer, Mishim Yahweh, apple is this being. So what do you do with your grief around the loss of habitat? What do you do with your grief about seeing the devastation of forests? And when you're not really allowed to grieve that in our culture? For me, I wrote this poem after Irma and after continuing to see our clear cutting of even the forest in the Amazon now. The one place where we always thought that was our safe, the lungs of the planet are being clear cut. So I had to do something with that grief. And so here is what I wrote, a much needed communion. There must be sounds from trees beyond all human recognition, like the pitch and the bellow of blue whales, only registered as infrasound or lines on a graph. But imagine the piercing screams as these towering land whales fall against hillsides, their thick bark breaking against the jaws of the saw one by one. This sound should leave a silent impression upon all our hearts. I only speak of this horror so you will know your walk in the woods is to the holy sanctuary of givers, whom communion is of earth and sun, conveys a certain quiet alchemy, a substantiation of light and mineral to air. Roots, trunks, branches, leaves, take this their body and breathe. So I ask why? Why sacrifice these saviors for toothpicks when the very lives, our very lives, depend upon the songs that they would sing together in the night? There is a role that despair plays in our lives. And I think that sometimes if we stay in that despair, we are just adding to the sadness. But if we are able to hold our despair and give rise to hope, then we can act. So in an effort to ease my own growing despair, I was compelled to make something of it. And amidst the growing sense of doom and gloom in the planet, Celebration Forest was born. So Celebration Forest is an invitation. It's an invitation to reimagine what it means to live in a forest, to help it come alive right where you are. It's an idea that is a virtual concept where in Florida or New York or anywhere you live, that you can begin to extend the tree canopy of Celebration Forest by simply planting a tree or two or three or seven or 100. And you can do this by looking at local property, community parks, libraries, schools, towns, cities, by donating to them to have trees planted or to raise funds so that you can do that yourselves, or simply plant a tree right where you are. I also wrote a children's book called Little Nut, and the proceeds of that book go to planting trees. But more importantly, what I saw were people just getting excited, not so much about the book, but about this idea of living in this forest, that we are living in this common forest called Celebration Forest, and we're making it real with every planting of every tree. You know, sometimes even a small difference can make a difference to the human spirit. And the good news is that none of us are alone in this. There are multitudes of people doing good works to help us connect to the green and help us to move forward out of this time of devastation to not only a life of sustainability, but to actually flourish, for life upon this planet to flourish. There is much power in making a way out of no way. And climate change, it's not a political issue. It's not a partisan issue. It is recognized as a global international security threat. And here at the 11th hour, I was heartened to some degree to know that in Florida in March 2020, a bill was passed, SB 178. It was the first time Republicans in the Republican-controlled Senate in Florida had moved to acknowledge climate change. That is a huge step. And it's one that I know you all can build upon, because I'm not sure that that bill has actually passed in entirety. And other legislation needs to happen in order to move us forward into a new era, a green era. And so while, you are planting trees, the invitation to plant trees. I invite you to get rooted as well, if you already are not rooted in legislative action. That is the one way that we can make a difference. And while it might seem that we can be in despair and feel like we have no power, we as a people of faith are called to act, to make a way out of no way. That is what we do. We take our despair and we turn it into hope, and then we turn it into action. Adrienne Rich says that there must be those among whom we can sit and we can weep and still be warriors. So I invite you to be a warrior for the green. What will come from your despair? Perhaps the first step is not action, but reflection, because the seeds of hope are found in what we love, in what we cherish. So we are entering into what I call Earth Day season, the spring equinox, Earth Day, Arbor Day. So I leave you with another poem, a poem that is not born from my despair, but out of a deep sense of connection and hope. It's entitled Winter Green. I, who have knelt before no gods this year, have a sudden need to kneel me in the snow, when round me like the rush of wings I hear, white falling on white, and the lone cry of owl into the soft night. I want to be found by restful sleeping branches, mystery and moonlight, and taken in by darkness and a star-filled sky. I sing out with my angel voice, clear my affirmation, all is calm as I wish it to be so. And in silence, I wait for the gentle coming of love and thanksgiving to fill this human heart and prepare in me a place for miracles. New life, come to harsh, barren landscapes, fill me with evergreen and the hope of this season and all seasons to follow. Let the greening begin. So may it be, and amen.
Some of you young folks been saying to me, "Hey, Pops, what you mean, what a wonderful world? How about all them wars all over the place? You call them wonderful? And how about hunger and pollution? They ain't so wonderful either. But how about listening to old Pops for a minute? Seems to me it ain't the world that's so bad, but what we are doing to it. And all I'm saying is, see what a wonderful world it would be if only we'd give it a chance. Love, baby, love. That's the secret. Yeah. If lots more of us loved each other, we'd solve lots more problems. And man, this world would be a guesser. That's why old Pops keeps saying, I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dog say goodnight, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Our closing words are from Clarissa Pinkola Estes from The Faithful Gardener. What is this process of spirit and seed that touches empty ground and makes it rich again? Its greater workings I cannot claim to understand. I only know that in its care, what has seemed dead is dead no longer. What seems lost is no longer lost. And that which some have claimed impossible is made clearly possible. And what ground is fallow is only resting and waiting for the blessed seed to arrive on the wind with all God's speed. And it will. Go forth in peace and be led back in joy. And go forth and be the good gift that you are to this world. We will extinguish the chalice, and with that, carry that light. Carry the light forward of illumination if you learned anything today. Something new of your own wisdom that has been shared through the ages. Carry that light and do not be afraid to do the one thing that you can do, no matter what people may say. And we have a closing hymn, Weave.
Hey, please put your screen in gallery view and hold hands with your neighbors. And let's weave a song of unity and love.